Marco Santori, Pillsbury, Winthrop, Shaw, Pittman.
It's good to see so many friendly faces in the audience this morning, but for those who don't know me, my name is Marco Santori. I lead the digital currency and blockchain technology team at Pillsbury Winthrop. It's an interdisciplinary team of attorneys all around the world, each focusing on a distinct area of law as it applies to blockchain technology. Pillsbury lawyers have been in this space since as early as 2011. So we've been around a while. As some of you may know, my team has been asked by the state of Delaware to serve as their ambassadors, their legal ambassadors to the blockchain industry, and we could not be more honored to serve in this role. As some of you may not know, when Delaware first approached me to set up their blockchain strategy, they were way out ahead of this issue. They weren't coming to me asking, who is the CEO of Bitcoin? They weren't coming to me asking, golly, how does mining work? No, their questions were far more sophisticated. They wanted to know, who are the credible players in this space? They wanted to know, can proof of work really be supplanted reliably by another mechanism? They wanted to know, could private and public blockchains really act together to serve the same transaction? They have been looking at this for a very long time, and they have been looking at it closely. And let's face it, so far the brief history of what's now known as just blockchain technology has been highly theoretical. Bitcoin evangelists, for example, have been giving us the promise of financial inclusion and the promise of the democratization of finance for some time. Advocates of blockchain technology have pitched blockchain as a panacea for just about every capital markets ill imaginable. In fact, there has been so much talk of the potential of blockchain technology that those turning that energy into something more kinetic, I think, are too few and too far between. The subtitle of this conference is Making Blockchain Real. And today, I have the distinct honor of introducing a man who will be making that very real for you today. I'm here to introduce Jack Markell, the governor of Delaware, a man who has a long history of taking innovative ideas and turning them into realities. In fact, the governor was one of the original tech entrepreneurs. He was employee number 13 at Nextel. In fact, he coined the name Nextel. Before his career in Once he entered politics, I should say, he was one of the few state governors to welcome globalization and welcome technological innovation into his state and recognize it for the juggernaut, the economic juggernaut that it turned out to be. As a result, he served his constituents well. Delaware has a thriving economy. The state has a AAA rating from all three ratings agencies since 2011 when the governor was treasurer. That's right. That's right, Governor Markell also served as treasurer of Delaware. He was elected to public office, not just as governor, but treasurer as well. And in fact, he has been elected to public office 5 times. Never has he lost an election. So, without further ado, it is my distinct honor to introduce Governor Jack Markell.
Well, thank you, Marco. Good morning, everybody. And while I am here to introduce and announce the Delaware Blockchain Initiative, I'm here for a more important reason, which is to announce that, in fact, I am Satoshi. It's great to be here today. And, Marco, I want to say it's been a pleasure to work with you and your team over the last several months. And what I'd like to share with this conference and the world today is what we've been working on together. But first, an observation, which is that this morning I had the opportunity to talk to a few companies here about the blockchain technology, and the thing that struck me most deeply was the diversity, a diversity of industries, of applications, and a diversity of visions for the future. And it's sort of similar to the kind of diversity that we have in our state. Now, to be sure, Delaware is the state of incorporation for the majority, the Fortune 500, a fact that we're proud of, but there's a lot more to our state than just the blue chips. We're the corporate home of 85% of all new U.S. IPOs and the majority of mid-sized to large venture-backed technology firms. And increasingly, we're bringing technology firms that transform how we live and work to locate their operations in our state as well. In every industry, from banking and finance to technology, Delaware has long been the gold standard for company formation. And I believe that we have maintained this superior position by carefully distinguishing what are mere trends from genuine paradigm shifts in the way that corporations do business. And an innovation that is now a few years old and rapidly reaching maturity is, in fact, the use of blockchain technology in business operations. In this conference, attended both by innovative startups and larger enterprise organizations, is really a perfect demonstration of the brain power and the resources behind this revolution. Now, for the enterprise, blockchain can eliminate layers of cumbersome and outdated and costly middle and back office settlement and clearance procedures. They can eliminate counterparty risk and free up billions of dollars in capital that's held in counterparty arrangements. They can speed the exchange of almost any asset that can be digitized for faster real-time settlement. And for the public, blockchain technology can help people move financial assets from one party to another more easily and inexpensively. And financial applications that are built on blockchain technology can be an on-ramp to the financial system for Delaware's and the world's unbanked and underbanked populations. And as Marcus said, I first served as state treasurer, and both in that position and as governor, I've worked hard to ensure that underserved communities have access not only to financial literacy programs, but also to affordable financial services. But the unfortunate reality is that the most vulnerable of our fellow citizens often still cannot afford basic financial services. And for members of the public with bad credit or no credit and no bank accounts, even those whose only device is a smartphone, blockchain technologies can offer access to the financial system at a price that they can afford. And we think that these public benefits as well as the private benefits are a perfect fit for our state, which has a long history of embracing innovation. Obviously, like many others, having embraced the sharing economy, not only throwing our own arms open wide, but also making sure that we have a welcoming regulatory and business environment. The enthusiasm for these new ways of doing business is indicative of a larger vision that we're implementing that recognizes that today's world is changing rapidly. And globalization and the technology revolution have permanently transformed our economy, and there is no going back. And I think these are the major factors at work on our economy. Employers have more choices than they've ever had before about where to locate and where to hire. And as a result of technology, many employers need relatively fewer people because of automation. And so those who believe that we can significantly address our economic challenges simply by punishing the big banks or simply by raising the minimum wage, although a raise in a national increase in the minimum wage makes sense, but those who think that those are the only solutions are going to see other states and other countries surpass us. Now, in Delaware, we know that winning the future is only possible when we foster innovation, when we train a skilled workforce to support the growing industries of the 21st century economy, and when we engage with the world to encourage exports and to attract foreign direct investment. And as a part of that approach. We want to be a leader in exploring the potential of the new technologies and innovations that are changing our world. So today, I continue Delaware's tradition of embracing change by announcing the official public launch of our blockchain initiative, which is a demonstration of the state's commitment to growth in the blockchain technology space. And there are four parts of our blockchain initiative. The first has to do with regulations. Now, it's a topic on the mind of every blockchain CEO these days. Delaware's approach to business and corporate regulation has always been to favor enabling statutes and to avoid one-size-fits-all solutions. This approach is embodied in our Delaware General Corporation Law, which is considered to be the most flexible and modern corporate statute in the country and probably the world. And more broadly, this approach is reflected in a regulatory reform effort that I launched in 2012 that eliminated or modified well over 100 outdated rules and regulations. And this approach is highlighted in landmark legislation I signed last year, the Delaware Regulatory Flexibility and Transparency Act, that requires state agencies to re-examine all regulations every 4 years and to consider alternative, cost-effective, and flexible methods of regulation. So obviously, we don't believe that governments should be prescriptive about regulating new industries. It's tempting to jump in early and to try to regulate away risks as soon as possible, but in doing so, we tend to regulate away some of the benefits as well. So instead, we believe the right approach is a descriptive one. We shouldn't sit back and wait as a government. We should actively observe. We should monitor. We should learn about how businesses manage the good and the bad of technological innovations, so that when the time comes to create regulations, we can describe in law all the things that we have already seen work in the industry. Now, this is in fact how Delaware became the dominant corporate domicile in the United States. We weren't the first state to have a corporate law, or the first state to create limited liability companies, or the first state to create business trusts, but we did actively observe, we learned from mistakes that were made in other jurisdictions, we adopted best practices, and ultimately we emerged with a system that's admired around the world. So in the blockchain space, we're taking a similar approach. Our bank commissioner is paying close attention to developments in other states that have adopted regulations, and he's committed to taking a balanced approach that encourages technological innovation and economic development while at the same time protecting Delaware residents who engage in transactions involving virtual currencies. But importantly, the state has no immediate plans to enact laws or to issue regulations regarding licensing of virtual currency or blockchain businesses. We want to actively observe, and if and when an appropriate time comes, we'll work with the industry and consumer groups to describe best practices. The second part of our initiative is particularly important and exciting to me. We've always been a front runner in addressing the practical needs of businesses as they seek efficiencies from new business processes and technologies. Now, in 1983, our corporate law endorsed the concept of uncertificated corporate shares, providing clarity that corporations could embrace new practices and technologies that eliminated the need for traditional paper stock certificates. As the internet and electronic transmission technologies gathered steam in the 1990s, we embraced the digital revolution, and we adopted a comprehensive technology amendment to our corporation statute to allow for electronic corporate record transmissions, electronic director votes, and virtual stockholder meetings. And taken together, these innovations have helped pave the way for greater efficiency in the way that corporations conduct business. So today I want to announce my office's support for the next logical step in this process. the development of a new category of corporate shares, distributed ledger shares. Right now, the state's in the planning stages. We believe this project has great potential, but we also must be prudent. Our aim, as it has always been in the corporate law, is to harness the benefits of new technologies while minimizing the risk for businesses. And like any new technology, integration can have its growing pains. But we believe the benefits could be tremendous. Settlement and clearance of equity trades can often take days, and there's simply no technological reason today that it should take that long. And distributed ledger shares hold the promise of immediate clearance, immediate settlement, and bringing with them dramatic increases in efficiency and speed in the sophisticated commercial transactions for which Delaware is known. Now, one specific example is the programmatic management of capitalization tables and share registries. Many companies are staying private longer and longer, and so keeping track of shareholder rights after 10 or more rounds of financing, each with different terms and conditions, can be like solving a logic puzzle, and companies are feeling this frustration every day. Well, our Delaware's legal community and our Division of Corporations see this as companies allocate significant financial resources to correct and to validate stock authorization and issuance errors that could have been correctly and seamlessly handled from the outset. And we believe that empowering Delaware companies to manage the entire process programmatically on a distributed ledger could be a great answer. In Delaware, we have a 49-year tradition of monitoring and updating our corporate statutes annually to address the evolving needs of shareholders, management, and businesses around the world. And that process involves strong, ongoing support from the Delaware State Bar Association's Corporation Law Council. Two of its members are here today, Matt O'Toole, who's the chair of the council, and Rick Geisenberger, who runs the Delaware Division of Corporations. And I am pleased that the council has agreed to explore the need for any changes or clarifications to our general corporation law to address and to enable the authorization of these distributed ledger shares. And this council can be expected to address as carefully and cautiously as we do all matters of corporate law, but I am confident that when there is demand, the council and our General Assembly will respond responsibly and promptly to the need. The third part of the Delaware Blockchain Initiative will be aiding companies to take advantage of all that Delaware has to offer. And I firmly believe that there is no better place for blockchain technology companies to do business than in Delaware. And we're located in the heart of the Northeast Corridor. We're the top business-friendly state in the country. We offer businesses a vibrant entrepreneurial environment, one of the nation's best legal and tax climates, responsive and focused state and local officials, and a highly educated workforce. And innovative technologies have become important sources of high-quality jobs for our state, and we work quickly to ensure that our citizens have the skills to be successful. For example, 2011, the University of Delaware opened the J.P. Morgan Chase Innovation Center, where faculty, students, and J.P. Morgan Chase employees work side-by-side on joint applied research projects. They built a pipeline of technology talent in Delaware to help drive innovation. Last year, Delaware was one of the first tech hire communities, which supports accelerated training programs that prepare Delawareans for both entry-level developer and IT and infrastructure jobs that are in high demand. And Tech Hire Delaware quickly established the Zip Code Wilmington Coding Boot Camp, sponsored by several of our largest corporate and banking employers to transform entry-level students into software engineers. Now, success in these efforts works both ways, helps citizens reach their full potential, but it also helps our business community gain access to the talent that they need. And it shows that we can adapt quickly, which we do, to meet these needs, when we're prepared to do the same in the blockchain space. And to welcome blockchain businesses into Delaware and to serve as this industry's point of contact for new opportunities, programs, and partnerships with our state, I've named Andrea Tiniano, the State Director of Corporate and International Development, as Delaware's and the nation's first state blockchain ombudsperson. She's a Delaware lawyer. She's got significant business development expertise, and I encourage you to meet her if you've not already, and she is here today as well. Now, the fourth part of our blockchain initiative, and perhaps the most important in the long run, is for Delaware to become a user of this technology. I see incredible potential in the use of blockchain technology as a foundational tool in the relationship between government, citizens, and businesses. And put simply, much of what government does is keep track of things. Nearly every government agency maintains some sort of public or private registry containing a combination of public or confidential records that originate from a citizen, a business, or a public official. So the potential applications for blockchain technology for governments are as limitless as they are in the private sector. The technology is already being envisioned for use in public land registries, and it's not difficult to imagine hundreds of possible business-to-government applications. And some examples that come to mind include the management and tracking of business and professional licensing records, secure transaction filings under the Uniform Commercial Code, court filings, and probate records. And the journey has got to start someplace. So I'm pleased today to announce plans to launch a State of Delaware blockchain. In conjunction with our partner Symbiont, we're developing a Delaware blockchain supported by smart contracts that can be used for both internal and external use cases. And we have immediate plans to dip our toes in the water, creating an infrastructure for managing and validating permanent records kept by the Delaware Public Archives. Our initial use case involves orders, agendas, and meeting minutes of the Delaware Public Service Commission. And I look forward to this technology helping to place our public archives at the forefront of digital forensics and electronic records management. So I want to thank a number of our partners who have been instrumental in developing the Delaware Blockchain Initiative. First, our legal ambassadors, Marco Santori, who you've met, and the blockchain technology team at Pillsbury Law. They know the technology, they can spot the risks, and they know how to leverage the rewards, and they've been very helpful to us. So if you want to know more about our blockchain initiative, please reach out to Marco. Our technology ambassadors are Mark Smith and the team at Symbiont. In fact, Mark told me this morning that that test case that I mentioned is already up and running. And Symbiont is a distributed ledger and smart security startup that focuses on smart contracts, truly one of the strongest teams in the space, both technologically and in terms of commercial experience. In fact, they've already been working closely with our state officials on how best to leverage this technology and this initiative, and I'm pleased to announce that they've decided to physically locate their headquarters, their new joint venture called Smart Loans, in the state of Delaware, and we welcome them to our state. So I hope you're as excited about this blockchain initiative as I am, and these are really just the first four steps. Ensuring that our regulatory environment is welcoming and enabling, creating an infrastructure, an appropriate legal infrastructure for distributed ledger shares, naming an ombudsperson to welcome this industry to Delaware, and committing our state government to the use of the technology. So today's announcement represents just the beginning of what I believe will be an historic development for business and technology. Delaware is open for business. We are open for blockchain business. And I welcome the opportunity for us to play a vital role in supporting the vision of Consensus 2016, mainstreaming real-world blockchain applications for consumers, businesses, and the public sector alike. Thank you all very much.
Please welcome Jerry Brito, Coin Center, Marco Santori, Pillsbury Winthrop Shaw Pittman, Mark Smith, Symbiont, Rick Geisenberger, Delaware Department of State, and Matthew O'Toole, Potter, Anderson, and Caroon.
My name is Jerry Brito. I'm a executive director of Coin Center, which is an independent nonprofit based in Washington, D.C. that focuses on the public policy issues affecting cryptocurrencies. And it's my pleasure to have such a great panel here today to discuss Delaware's newly announced blockchain initiative. We've got Marco Santori, who you all know as the blockchain ambassador to Delaware. We have Mark Smith, CEO of Symbiont. We have Rick Geisenberg, Delaware Chief Deputy Secretary of State, who heads up the Delaware Division of Corporations, and Matthew O'Toole from Potterson, Ander, and Caroon, but he's also chair of the corporate law section of the Delaware State Bar Association. So why don't I begin with Rick and Matthew and ask you this. Delaware has a long history of being at the center of corporate law in the United States. Do you want to tell us a bit about that history and how this initiative fits into it?
Sure. Well, I mean, Delaware, as the governor noted, was not the first state to adopt a corporate law. Actually, the first state to adopt a corporate law was New Jersey. And Delaware copied New Jersey's law in around 1899, and over time did it better than New Jersey, quite frankly. And there have been, over time, our market share grew and grew until the point now where 66% of the Fortune 500, 85% of all U.S. IPOs, most venture-backed companies are now incorporated in our state. And there's lots of reasons why that's true. The first is our statute, which is generally acknowledged to be the most modern and flexible corporate law in the country. The second component are our courts, which are the most widely respected business courts in the United States. We have a special court called the Court of Chancery that deals exclusively with corporate governance issues, issues involving managers and shareholders. The third piece is our corporate legal community, which I'll let Matt talk about. And the fourth piece is the Division of Corporations, which has organized its functions around the fact that we have businesses all over the world and all over the country that use our services. And so we've been an early adopter of new technologies for over 35 years, the first state to have a database, the first state to have imaging, the first state to have workflows, the first state to use the internet, and now hopefully the first state to use blockchain. So I'll let Matt talk about his piece of it, which is the corporate legal community in Delaware.
There's been a public-private partnership that's been in place in Delaware for about half a century now, where the Bar Association supports our legislature and our governor in maintaining our business organization statutes. It's really been a very effective partnership. And what we strive for in our laws, our corporation laws, our LLC statutes, our partnership laws, is really to have balance, to respond to the needs of the marketplace, and to maintain flexibility so companies can operate in the most efficient way possible. We have a track record, to allude to Jerry's question about how blockchain fits into this. We do have a track record of responding to technological advances and allowing companies to implement those. The governor mentioned in his remarks, back in the late 90s, we had amendments to our corporation law to allow for technologies that were emerging at that time, email, the internet, and so forth. So I think we'll draw on that experience in the context of looking at our corporation law now to explore the advisability, the implementation of distributed ledger shares.
So as you're alluding to, there are going to be certain changes, perhaps, to the corporate law that will have to be made to take into account what the governor announced today. What do you expect those changes to be, and how long do you suspect they'll take to...
I would hope that by this time next year we'll have proposals developed. I don't want to prejudge where we'll end up on this, of course, but clearly the technology holds the promise for efficiency and certainty and security, and that's worth pursuing, clearly. We'll take, as the governor mentioned, we take a pretty deliberate approach to these types of initiatives. There will be a careful, studious approach, but an open-minded approach. And I would expect that effort will start in earnest, probably in the very near term. We're at the starting line here, not near to the finish line. But I would expect that by this time next year, we ought to be through that process and have a view on what the right approaches.
And I'll mention that's the normal cycle of our legislature adjourns in June. So we start up again as soon as they, and this year's corporate law package will probably be introduced in the next day or two.
Right. That's very speedy by
standards. But this is very speedy, as Marco can attest to. And we are really the only state that takes this approach. I mean, of looking at it every single year, meeting on a very regular basis. You know, in most states, they might amend their corporate law every 5 or 6 years. We're looking at it every year, and I think that's important in this, especially when you're talking about technology, which is, you know, our goal is to have something for this time next year, but we also recognize that there may be developments, things we learn over time, and we may need to revisit, you know, whether additional enabling legislation is necessary, you know, within a year or two later.
Okay. So I'm going to ask Mark, something the governor announced today is a partnership with Symbiont to build a blockchain for Delaware. Can you tell us, give us some more specifics, what exactly are you building and why Symbiont? What does Symbiont's blockchain have that others don't?
Sure. So first of all, I'd like to thank Ryan and the team at Consensus for allowing us to kick off this very important conference and make this what we believe is a historic announcement. We're very fortunate at Symbiont to partner with market leaders in all areas where we believe this technology will be valuable, and obviously partnering with Marco and Pillsbury is an important step to that. I think what makes Symbiont unique and a very good fit for Delaware is that we have a very flexible and extensible system. So our platform is really designed around smart contracts and being neutral to the underlying ledger layer. So as everybody here is aware, there are certain use cases where compliance, regulation, privacy requires restriction on those who are on a distributed ledger, where other use cases allow for public ledgers like the Bitcoin blockchain to be utilized. Symbiont's unique system allows us to put our smart contracts on any of those. So when you say, what's the differentiating characteristic about our blockchain, our ledger, it's not about the ledger layer for us, it's about the intelligence of the smart contract. So with the state of Delaware, we'll explore different types of use cases on different types of ledgers, not precluding the utilization of public ledgers where public documentation, as the governor spoke of, would be appropriate to have on that particular ledger.
So what do you think are, like, can you give us one or two use cases that you think might drive efficiencies for Delaware that would make sense that you can envision right now potentially being there?
Sure. I mean, I think the governor had mentioned this, and Rick and I have spoke about this at length. So, of course, the state of Delaware is the platinum standard for incorporation. And it was that position in the market that drove Marco and I to present this opportunity to the state of Delaware, especially around Article 8 of the UCC, which was mentioned previously. But even more so, being able to secure positions on liens with UCC filings are extremely exciting. But internal utilization, The state has been very forward and talk about fast. When we finally made a commitment to this project, they proposed some potential first use cases. We determined that the archive group is the right place to start due to the nature of pruning the database and those things. And they delivered a record to us on Monday, and we had it up by Thursday on our permissioned ledger as a smart contract. So that's the first step, and then we have a long-term roadmap. We see this as a marathon, not a sprint. So over the course of many years, our partnership with Delaware will grow, and hopefully we'll be able to deploy this into many internal use cases as well as external facing ones, and maybe come up with some new things that we can do together.
Okay. So I want to mention that when we first met with Governor Markell to talk about this initiative, it was a three-part initiative, and we got to the end of the meeting with the governor, and the governor said, it's a really exciting three-part initiative. I want a fourth part. I want the state to jump in.
Right.
And, you know, we only had a few weeks, actually, to work with these folks to figure out what that fourth part was going to be. And we came up with, initially starting with the public archives. But I think it really demonstrates the governor's commitment to this, to say, let's have the state government start to do this. And I think there's no better way for us to understand And I think it will inform and help the deliberations of the Corporation Law Council in figuring out how do we make this possible for private sector issuers of stock. So lots and lots of opportunity.
And as the CEO of the state of Delaware, I can tell you that the governor acted quicker than almost any other CEO I've met with or tried to work with. So what you would imagine in that kind of very public area would be slow and elongated in the process. The governor was very decisive and innovative, and we were able to move forward very quickly.
That's great. So, Marco, let me ask you, you're a newly minted Bitcoin, or I should say, not Bitcoin, blockchain ambassador for the state of Delaware. Of course, you head up the blockchain practice group at Pillsbury. What does it mean to be now this new role? What does it mean to be an ambassador? What is it, your role now?
Well, you know, as I said in my introduction, I'm not doing much education. I mean, when Delaware came to me, they were way out ahead of this issue. They were not the babes in the woods that so many technologists imagine government actors to be. They had been looking at this for a long time. I think they understood that there were risks and they understood that there were benefits. But they wanted to charge ahead and with an eye on being careful, and that's something that they've asked me to do as a conduit for the industry. And so the team has asked that we try to close the knowledge gap on the issues that are still outstanding, and bring to them the ideas and the potential processes and procedures that can really make this a successful program. So we'll be...
What can companies and entrepreneurs in this space and technologists who are excited by this announcement today expect?
Yeah. Well, this is, in my opinion, a significant event in the course of corporate affairs, not just in Delaware, not in the United States, but globally. And I think that this affects public companies, it affects private companies, it affects young companies that are looking to IPO soon. We have a one-year-ish time horizon before this becomes particularly concrete in the minds of the legislature. And 1 year is about that time is when you start planning an IPO. So those who are looking to IPO, this is at the forefront of what you should be looking at. Those public companies who are already traded on exchanges, look, your distributed ledger shares are going to be more liquid than other shares. They are going to have greater efficiency of settlement and clearance. This is something that investors want, and this is something that that anyone who's incorporated in Delaware, who's an LLC in Delaware, any Delaware entity, and quite frankly, entities who are incorporated in other states, should be looking at Delaware to see, well, this is a real opportunity for us to have shares that can be traded on a blockchain, that can be traded quickly. This, as they say, nothing good happens between trade and settlement, right? So the closer we can contract that time, the more efficient your transactions and corporate shares are going to be, and that's what that's part of the promise of this today. Right?
Rick, let me ask you, is the Delaware Blockchain Initiative only for private blockchains? What are your thoughts on open blockchains?
So. I mean, as the governor said, I mean, I think this is there are opportunities in both areas. Obviously, you know, the when you're talking about corporate shares, you know, it may depend on whether you're talking about, you know, a company in its early stages where it's privately held, where you know, versus what happens when a company goes public. I think in the public sector there are tremendous opportunities potentially for more open blockchains. I think you know, you talked about the secure transaction registry, which is obviously an open registry. All of the documents in it are public record. Delaware, because of a unique provision in the Uniform Commercial Code that requires that secured transactions be registered in the jurisdiction in where the debtor is incorporated, and that was a provision that changed in 2001, where Delaware perhaps got, I don't know, 2% of the filings nationally, now gets something like 10% of the filings nationally. So if we went down this path, there's an opportunity to work really with all 50 states and the District of Columbia and all the territories. And that sort of a blockchain, I would imagine, would be far more open. I mean, it's a public registry where all of the information are public, all the data and all of the information are public records. So.
Do you have a history of that? Is there a precedent for getting other states on board with initiatives that Delaware has brought on and building that out?
I would have to say no at this point. Maybe after today, I'll be getting a lot of phone calls from my peers in other jurisdictions. I will say, I mentioned to someone last night at dinner that you know, we've been talking about this, as Marco said, for some time, but my national association, which is the commercial administrators in all 50 states, has a conference coming up, and they just announced their agenda. And we have an international section of folks from Europe who also participate in our conference. And it turns out that blockchain technology is on that agenda. So I found that very interesting. I think it's coming from Europe, not from within the US. So obviously it's being, I don't think that would have appeared on our agenda unless there were a number of European corporate registrars who must be thinking about this already or perhaps already using it. And if they're thinking about it, I'm sure the United States will be as well.
That's interesting. Marco, I want to ask you about that. There's been a lot of comparisons between Europe and the U.S. And lately, it seems like you're just sort of taking a pole position. You want to talk about that?
Yeah, so from a regulatory perspective, which is where most of the law started in this area, the U.S. has been light years ahead of Europe and most of the world. Now, you might not like where we've ended up. You might have, you know, you might have qualms about the, for example, 50-state licensing for digital currency companies. But the team, both on the federal level and among the states in the U.S., is far, far ahead of where Europe is today. But, like you've said, that's changed dramatically over the last few weeks. 2 weeks ago, I was asked to speak at a round table at the European Parliament. These folks are just starting this conversation. It's a conversation that's been going on really since mid-2013 here in the U.S., and now Europe is starting to pick this up. There is a draft plan of action that's been put together by the European Commission to include some virtual currencies, and they're looking also at blockchain technology generally in the Payments Directive and the AML Directive. But I think what's interesting about Delaware is that this is not a regulatory story. This is not a question of prescriptive laws. This is a question of enabling statutes, and that's some of the work that we're doing at Pillsbury. We're working on proposed amendments to the Delaware corporate law, to the Delaware commercial code. So everyone's talking about licensing and registration, and golly, is this stuff a security, or is this going to require a money services license? That's an important story, and it's a story that we've all been living since 2013. But I think the more important thing that's happening now is the commercial law story. How do we actually make this happen as a matter of commerce? How do we recognize final settlement in the context of the Uniform Commercial Code? These are the issues that, quite frankly, I think are more challenging than the regulatory issues.
Mark, you seem to be agreeing violently with that. Do you want to tell us?
Violently, yes. What, the nodding dog.
Yeah, what do we need? And so obviously Delaware's the first step. Where do you see this going?
Well, I get excited because I get quite wonkish about rules and regulations. I know that sounds strange. I come from a very long history of being regulated by the alphabet soup of every regulator. And I think that when you have a very powerful technology and you can understand the regulatory landscape, you can get in front of it and really create a huge value proposition where some people may have thought it's restrictive. I see opportunities. And the state has been very forward thinking about how to address this. We believe there should be rules and regulations around this because uncertainty, if you ask the majority of the CEOs out here that have startups or are running operating businesses, what's the biggest issue? It's not regulation, it's uncertainty around regulation. We just want to run our business in a way where we know we can be compliant. And the state of Delaware is a fantastic partner to say, we're there with you, we're going to help guide what is compliant and what is not. And from a technological perspective, pitching our own book, we've designed our system to be compliant based on different use cases. So as we talked about different ledgers, the state's going to have really strong ideas about where things should go, and then being able to partner with someone like Marco with the foresight to see what's happening all over the world, we can have best practices.
So Matthew, you seem to be agreeing violently with Mark when he's talking about regulatory uncertainty.
Well, yeah, I, to pick up on the governor's remarks again, I mean, he talks about our enabling approach to legislation. So I think that what we're striving to do here is to provide some certainty that if we conclude it's advisable, if the General Assembly and the governor determine that this is the path they want to take, we'll make it clear in our corporation law that distributed ledger shares are permissible. My expectation is that we won't have, as Marco describes, a very rigid framework in terms of detailing how you go about creating those types of shares. We'll probably have some sort of large principle-based framework in terms of criteria that ought to be met, not detail-oriented, to allow for this approach to be taken.
And if I can just say,
sure.
The reality may well be that these distributed ledger shares are already permissible under Delaware corporate law. In fact, it's like so many other things in Delaware corporate law. When we're approached with a new idea, we often say, well, of course it's allowed, but then the actual users and industry groups will say, well, can you bring some clarity to the statute so that we know that should we get in a dispute, should we have a dispute between managers and shareholders or among shareholders, that when we get to court, that the court won't, you know, ask the question whether this was permissible. So, we've made a number of changes over the last, you know, really 40 years to try to, when we're asked by industry groups, is this allowed, you know, can you expressly make it clear so that there's no, and I think that realistically that people are going to be reluctant to do these distributed ledger shares until we bring that clarity.
You know, lawyers know that one of the reizons that Delaware is such a prized jurisdiction for corporate law is its chancery court. Is it at all difficult, or do you expect any challenges given that this is such a complicated area of technology, or do you think the chancery court will understand what you're doing here?
The Chancery Court judges are pretty sharp, so I would imagine that they'll have no problem embracing this and getting their arms around it.
Okay. Mark, I want to ask you about something else that the governor announced, which is that you are locating physically to the state of Delaware. I mean, so that's terrific. Why are you doing that, and why are you giving that up? Are you moving from where, from New York?
No, Symbiont's headquarters won't be moving, but if you follow us in the media, we have a joint venture partnership with IPRIO,
okay,
specifically around syndicated loans. And as part of that, there's a back office group, an operating group, shall we call them? Since we do get rid of the Midland back office, I won't call them back office.
Okay.
There's an operating group that exists today in North Carolina,
okay,
and we'll be moving that operating group to Delaware.
And why'd you choose
And we're doing it to show our commitment to the state, as they've shown to us, as well as because if we're going to be using different types of ledgers, and the Bitcoin blockchain is one of them, we want to make sure we're in a state where we know that there won't be new rules and regs that come up that, you know, prevent us from being able to operate our business. So it's an exciting place to be. We really want to eat our own dog food and show our strong partnership with Delaware, so we're happy to move there.
Marco, do you think other companies might be moving to Delaware?
I think so. Part of the vision that we've been discussing is the development of a real tech hub in Delaware, which is not new. It's something that has been sort of quietly underway for some time. I think Rick can probably speak to this a little bit more closely, but there is already an incubator and training center, right, in Delaware?
Yes. So, I mean, Delaware has a population of about 1 million people. But 10% of our private workforce works in financial services and corporate services. And, you know, they're great jobs, they're clean jobs. And, you know, this governor, under his leadership, has been working very hard to build the sort of infrastructure that can support those jobs. And if you look at the growth of financial services in Delaware, which began in the 1980s with some financial regulatory reform, we're seeing a transformation in what those jobs are. I mean, those jobs, you know, were back office, pushing paper, and that kind of thing. And today, they're totally transforming into technology jobs. And, you know, our largest private sector employer is now JP Morgan Chase, and they just they're opening up a 3,000 person innovation center in northern Wilmington, and every single job will be a technology job. So. The migration of those services has been tremendous, and we've been building the infrastructure both in our in our high schools. Actually, the governor could talk more about in more detail than I can, but there's a lot of work with our high schools and our middle schools, and certainly with the University of Delaware and Delaware State University to build that workforce that can continue to feed those jobs. So,
Marco, not to take the focus off of Delaware, but I know that you've also been working with New Jersey on different initiatives there. Do you want to give us an update on that and tell us how it's the same or different from what you're doing in Delaware?
Sure. So just by way of background, the New Jersey Economic Development and Commerce Committee in the State Assembly came to me and asked me to draft a new Bitcoin law. That's what they called it. It was a digital currency law. In fact, it ended up being titled the New Jersey Digital Currency Jobs Creation Act. And it is a regime that is sort of a mix of carrots and sticks, economic incentives to, as a technology company, come into New Jersey and to develop digital currency technology. And also carrot, that's the carrot and also the sticks. It was sort of in the wake of the New York Bit license, which many of us are familiar with, which is a licensing regime. The New Jersey regime was a registration regime, similar to what you have on the federal level. It says, look, bring in your business to New Jersey so that we can study it, so that we can learn from it, so that we as law enforcers and regulators can eventually, when it comes time to make new law, take a descriptive approach. We can describe what we've seen work and what we've seen not work in law. We can describe that in law. And that's actually not all that dissimilar from the vision behind the new, behind the Delaware initiative, which is primarily that there is no current intention to develop new prescriptive regulations for digital currency companies, for virtual currency companies. That's not just a business-friendly kind of attitude. That is a deliberate decision on how to regulate, which is to learn from the industry. It's not delegating enforcement off to a self-regulatory or organization or sitting on your hands and doing nothing. It's being proactive to bring businesses into the state where you can monitor them, you can identify them, you can keep a tabs on who's holding your citizens' money, who's holding their digital assets and securities. Make sure that those people don't get too far. But at the same time, observe, monitor, see what's working and what's not working, so that when the time does come, we will have the information that we need to actually create those regulations. It's the same vision in both projects. I believe it's a smart one. I believe it balances consumer protection and encouraging innovation. I think it's the right way to go, and I think a lot of states can learn from what Delaware is doing here today.
All right. We've got less than 2 minutes left. Any last thoughts, or what are the next steps soon?
So, well, I do want to talk a little bit about this initial pilot that we've done with Symbiont, which I think is really, really interesting. And I got an email. They were so quick, and I guess we sent you the use case on Wednesday, and you had it up on Friday, which was really incredible. And our state archivist sent me an email last night that just had one word. It said, wow. So if you want to Google Steve Mars and look at his picture, you're going to see a face of a kind of guy that doesn't get wowed too often. It really is incredible. And it's a great place to start, in my mind, looking at the public archives, because that's where these records ultimately end up. And so it's going to give us an opportunity to look at, but of course all of these records originate often in the private sector, right, and make their way into the public archives, or make their way into a state agency, into a state agency's database and imaging systems, and then eventually into. So we're going to see what some of the best opportunities are for many, many additional use cases, and ultimately, the question is going to become, you know, how do we originate those documents using a blockchain so that when they do get accessioned and arrive in the archives 30 years later, they're just there. So we're very excited by it, and we want to particularly thank Mark and Marco for just incredible support that they've given us over the last number of months on this.
You made it easy, I tell you that. That's been
all
fantastic.
Right. Well, that's the last word.
Yeah, just a final point. Look, I think it's easy to overlook a lot of these announcements as as things that happen at conferences. But the title of this conference is making, the subtitle is Making Blockchain Real. There's so much talk and there's so much hype. There's so many, quite frankly, technology folks at the companies and banks and financial institutions that we represent coming to the CEO, the general counsel, and saying, we put a security on a blockchain, we put a bond on a blockchain. And the GC says, well, that's nice, but how do we know that's actually going to be recognized in law? How do we know it's actually going to work? How do we know it's not just bits and bytes flying around a network? How do we know it's real? And that's the first step that we're taking today, is making it real.
And I'll challenge all the CEOs and startups out there, find Andrea, talk to her about coming to Delaware, follow us there. We think it's a fantastic place to be.
All right, multiple last words. Thank you all for listening.
Thank you very much.
And thanks to the panel.
Please welcome Pete Rizzo at CoinDesk, Jeremy Allaire, and Sean Neville at Circle.
Welcome, everybody. Pete Rizzo, editor for CoinDesk. Really glad you all could make it here. I want to do a little bit of introduction on these two guys we have right here, because we're pleased to welcome to my left, Jeremy Allaire, CEO and founder at Circle Internet Financial, founder of Allaire Corp, and created the development language Cold Fusion. To my left over there, far left, Sean Neville, co-founder and president at Circle, former senior software architect at Brightcove, worked at the online video startup founded by Jeremy, Brightcove, which went public in 2012. So words about these guys together. Circle has raised $76 million so far, most recent $50 million Series C. Investors include Goldman Sachs, Fenway Summer, General Catalyst. They're also the only startup in the industry yet to receive a BIT license in the state of New York. And today, Circle lets users send and receive Bitcoin globally. You can load your Circle Pay apps with US dollars and UK pounds. So before we get to these guys, I want to make use of the big audience we have here. Make you guys stretch your hands a little bit. So how many people today, how many people here have used or downloaded the Circle Pay app? Show of hands. Okay. Interesting. Okay, how many people have used the app to send or receive Bitcoin? Few hands there. How many people have used the app to send or receive traditional currencies today? That's US dollars, British pounds. And a few hands there. Okay. So tossing it over to you guys. So which of these markets are you currently targeting today? They look about the same. So what feedback does that give you? And, you know, what does that say about what you're doing?
Yeah, sure. We're focused on just trying to make money work the way that the internet works. We live in a world where we can share content and messages and information globally, instantly, for free, and in generally delightful ways. A lot of good user experiences around how we do all of that, and we just want to have that work for consumers the same with how they store and exchange value and money. So that's really the focus. It's sort of building social payment apps. And I think what's exciting about, being able to use something like Bitcoin and the blockchain is there's a way to now do that in an open way. We're not just building something that where everyone has to use Circle. We're building something where if there's another financial service, another technology company, another digital wallet, another merchant processor, anyone that supports blockchain protocols, then we can send and receive value with that as well. And so that's a sort of open model, and we think that's what makes the internet really compelling, is that it's an open, global, distributed network, and we want to have money work the same way.
So, Sean, you agree with that?
Yeah, absolutely. In terms of the mix between Bitcoin and other currencies that we may support, the purpose, the problem that we're working on is really making exchange of value globally work the same way sharing photos or opinions or any other kind of content on the internet already works. It's not necessarily to introduce new kinds of currency, although that's an interesting space as well. That's not what we're focused on. And so technologies like Bitcoin enable us to realize that vision. They're key to making sure that it is a thing that can happen now. Right. But the focus isn't on introducing Bitcoin itself as a currency to people and having them replace the money that they get paid in and pay their bills in with something new.
Mm. Well, I think you know, people still think of Circle, they think of digital currency. You know, even in your recent announcement with the e-money license in the UK, that was a very traditional kind of payments company announcement, but there was still a lot of buzz around you guys as a digital currency company. So I guess, how does the UK license start off there in relationship with Barclays? So what are you doing now with Barclays? How does that change the app and change how people can use it?
Sure, I'll take part of that. So you know, to use our service, we want to let people hold their local currency, so US dollar if you're here, or pound sterling in the UK, and send or receive value with that currency. And that's a regulated activity. So we have to be regulated as a money service business to do that. And we need to have a banking partner who can store that central bank money for us. Mm-hmm. You know, the banks have databases that are sort of regulated by government, and we need to synchronize to those databases in order to actually hold central bank money. So, we work with banks to do that. So what it technically means, though, just for an everyday consumer, is if they want to send and receive sterling, they can do that instantly for free, like they would send an instant message or Skype for communications. And they can do that instantly to the US and vice versa without fees. And they can also do it over the blockchain without actually using Bitcoin itself. They just transmit sterling and they can send it to any Bitcoin address in the world. So that's sort of what it does.
So I guess over to Sean. So was this progressive regulators here, or was this you guys being strong compliance? Again, we've seen you guys come out, you know, in the U.S. and the U.K. Really being, I guess, the lead in terms of getting interacting with governments and getting their approval for the activities that you guys are doing.
Yeah, I mean, I think just to build on what Jeremy was saying, anytime we go into a market with the Circle product, we need the right product, we need the ability to market the product, but we also need regulatory approval, because we're not a bank. We need the approval of the people who have the authority to connect to the banking system in all those regions in which we want to participate, so long as we want to participate in that banking system. So we need that, and we need it's a mix of regulatory approval and a banking partnership. So we knew from the very beginning that was going to be important for us, and so we invested from day zero in looking into what it meant to educate regulators, knowing that there is opportunity for innovation and regulation as well. What does the investment look like to educate regulators, work with progressive regulatory regimes and progressive banks? And certainly the UK over the last year or so has been very progressive in this particular space, more so than the United States.
So I guess focusing on the Barclays aspect of it, I know there's a lot of people here from traditional financial institutions or businesses. I guess, how does Barclays benefit from this partnership? I mean, some banks, financial institutions, they still consider even companies that are using the blockchain for things like payments to be maybe more of a high risk. How does that, I guess, what would you say the value add that you guys bring to Barclays is? What is that value add as a partner?
Yeah, I think, and this is in some ways similar to the early days of the internet, and people use that analogy over and over again, but I think, when online service companies were coming out, media and communications companies partnered with a lot of those and figured out ways to go to market together. And I think in this fintech space, not just digital currency, but internet finance and fintech more broadly, there are, technology-driven companies, software-driven companies that are innovating fast, and where they need underlying services to offer their products. And I think large financial institutions want to work with companies that are inventing the future and partner with that and have the benefit of learning, but also revenue. At the end of the day, these are sales and commercial relationships that can generate a lot of value. I think there are probably a lot of large financial institutions that wish they had become PayPal's bank early on or whatnot. And it's, large global financial institutions have a lot of lines of business. There's wholesale, there's retail, there's investment banking. There's so many different lines of business in banking. It's not like, this narrow kind of view. And so to work on a wholesale basis with other financial institutions around the world is a core part of what large banks do. And we're just another financial institution to work with.
So we've also seen a lot of digital currency startups and blockchain startups. You know, they're looking to provide banks consulting. They're looking to work on R&D kind of projects with them. I mean, Sean, is that something that you guys are doing here, or is this really just a basic partnership that enables your service specifically?
There's a number of different aspects of the partnership, but we are really focused on creating a great consumer product, and that's a hard thing to do. So that's really our focus. It's not so much you know, R&D effort with existing financial institutions, although that's a very valuable thing to do. We don't want to spread ourselves too thin. It's hard to do what we're doing. We're not quite there yet with the product. We're getting very, very close, improving all the time. And that's the thing that we need to focus on. And I think Barclays is very interested in, and other financial institutions are very interested in seeing how consumers want to interact with value exchange. What is this value exchange world look like in a you know, set of behaviors that are based on messaging on phones and sharing photos socially and expecting that to be free and instant and global and permissionless? What does it look like to take those behaviors and attach value or request value to it?
Jeremy,
I was just going to add to that. I think we're in an interesting time when we've always known, you know, or if you actually kind of study closely, money is just data and it's a record keeping system. And increasingly, it literally is just data, and the manifestation of money is just software, how it's the transactions are processed, debits and credits are made, how information is exchanged. It's all just software. But critically, we're in a place now with smartphones in particular where, you know, we have a payment instrument which is all software-based, principally. And so what that means, and laddering off of what Sean said, is really for the first time, we can now innovate in the user interface of money. In a way that we've never been able to do before. And so I actually don't think any of us know what the user interface of money is going to be in 5 years or 10 years, right? You know, people thought SMS was like, that was the end of messaging, right? iMessage, okay, we all have SMS, et cetera. But obviously that's not the case because people want to communicate and share messages in a lot of different ways. And actually it turns out there are ways that billions of people want to use that have nothing to do with that. And I think similarly, now that money is just software, we're in a world where we can really experiment with what the UI of money is. And so that's in part what Sean is alluding to, is like our focus is just how do we just iterate constantly on what the UI and user experience for money should be.
Mm-hmm. So I'm curious, I guess, you know, from some of your older users, you know, there's a lot of comments about Circle, you know, have you guys changed? You know, have you guys evolved the service? Even kind of when we spoke, you know, you're used to the word database, money is software now. Maybe 2 years ago, we didn't, you know, talk like that in the industry. It was digital currency. It was global currency. I mean, these were kind of things that were how we explained the technology. So has it changed? Has the language changed? Have you changed? What, or has nothing changed?
Go for it.
Yeah, I think some of the terms, we're all sort of as a community struggling with terms. I mean, now we talk about distributed ledgers instead of blockchain and the whole blockchain versus Bitcoin. And we have sort of a nomenclature issue that we're all playing with. We haven't changed what we wanted to do with Circle. From the very beginning, we wanted to work on consumer experience with money, not just with Bitcoin or any other digital currency technology. We knew that being able to iterate on the user experience of money was possible now, partly because of Bitcoin, also because of cloud infrastructure and economies of scale, also because of advancements in risk technologies. Not just Bitcoin, but Bitcoin was one of the important enabling technologies that made us think that now's the time that we could do that. That was true all the way, you know, at the original inception of the company. But for many reasons, it takes time to build banking partnerships, regulatory approvals to work with the existing banking system. So to oversimplify a little bit, if we were faced with a decision of let's stay in stealth for 2 years while we acquire all the licenses that we need, and ultimately release a product that supports sterling, euros, dollars, and so forth. Should we do that? Or can we release what we can release right now, which is the easiest, most convenient way to get Bitcoin? And that's what we did.
So I guess I want to turn to your use of the technology. So Circle is a company that's using the Bitcoin blockchain as a way to attack payments. But I think there's a lot of fear from traditional financial institutions, for maybe businesses, for using the protocol in the same way. So I guess how or why is the Bitcoin blockchain still the best choice for a company like Circle? Jeremy?
Sure. I mean, we as you're noting, the nomenclature moves around here, but this idea of public blockchains I think is a really important one, and it's this idea that there's a open set of protocols that anyone in the world can plug into and use that is, in this particular case, for settling a transaction in a highly secure, immutable, irreversible manner. That's a really powerful thing. If you have a secure network that you can do that with and you don't have to trust a third party to settle that transaction, that's extremely powerful. And the more open the network, the broader the network, the more nodes on the network, and the more people that interact with it, the more valuable it is as a network. And right now, the only public blockchain that really has scale, security, and liquidity is the Bitcoin blockchain. There's just nothing else that has the scale today and the level of security today that we can trust it to settle transactions. So it's there, but you know, like we like to say, I think, you know, in 5 years or 10 years, it's quite likely that none of us are using Bitcoin. It may be called something else. It might be Ethereum. It might be something that's a hard fork of Bitcoin. But we're not wedded to Bitcoin. This isn't an ideological movement for us. But we are wedded to the idea of open protocols and public blockchains and open networks that can be used as sort of secure trust machines. That makes a ton of sense. That is sort of here. And it may be that Bitcoin is that, or we call it that. It may be that it's something else. We think it's the right technical innovation, and having a global public blockchain makes a great deal of sense. But you know, how many of us use Netscape Navigator? Anyone?
Show of hands in the back.
You know, or NCSA Mosaic, or you know, et cetera, or AOL Instant Messenger. These technologies go through a lot of iterations, both public open standards as well as privately executed technologies, and we're still in the early days of this.
So we are very much wedded to the idea of iteration on the open version of that. I mean, there is a legitimate, you know, call it a distributed ledger architectural pattern or, you know, use of this kind of technology in a, not even necessarily a completely trustless environment, but maybe where there's some trust. You know, for example, some competitors who are operating under the same regulatory requirements, for example. So the equivalent of an intranet, applying the technology to that sort of system, that's interesting, but we're much more interested in the open version of that, the internet. Not that the two are in competition with one another from a practical perspective, but sometimes they are from an intellectual, you know, priority perspective.
So how do you guys follow projects like a R3, like a Hyperledger, and how do you evaluate them? Are you evaluating what they're doing? I know some of it's still in testing, but I mean, I guess, is it relevant to you? Do you pay attention, and if so, how, and what are you looking for?
I mean, we read white papers.
And a comment? Okay.
But, you know, there are going to be really interesting consortia projects that are useful for any financial institution, and as those go to production, it'll be interesting to see the practical real-world use cases. We don't settle commercial paper transactions, securities, bonds, you know, that kind of stuff. That's not our core business, so that's not really relevant for us. We're focused on, you know, how do consumers exchange currency value around the planet instantly without fees. So we're very focused on that consumer value exchange problem as opposed to many of the other financial infrastructure products and issues that large FIs face.
Let's go back to the consumer question, because I think you guys are, you know, we've seen a lot of startups in the industry pivot away from consumers. A lot of the activity now is happening on the business end, solving, as you said, commercial paper, you know, big institutional problems. So, you know, I guess why are you convinced that this idea that blockchain is the best way to enable social payments? I mean, we've seen things come out like Square Cash, Google Wallet. I mean, there's a whole evolution of products that have tried this. You know, it's very well-worn territory. What does a blockchain-based payments app add if it's not the digital currency?
Yeah, we both have a lot to say.
We have a lot to say. Yeah, I'll give a little bit of context, and so. This category of social payment apps is actually a new category, certainly in the U.S., certainly in the West. It's not a new category in China. Hundreds of millions of people use social payment apps as an everyday, you know, kind of aspect of life. And the idea that you'd combine your friend graph, messaging, media, and payments together in an integrated way is just taken for granted, and 500 million people do it. Now, in the U.S., maybe 5 million people do it, maybe 10 at most. And in Europe, no one does it. So this category is a new category. It's not well-treaded. What is well-trotted, though, or treaded, I don't know what the word is, is people building closed payment networks. Google Wallet's a closed payment network. Venmo's a closed payment network. You have to be on their network to exchange value. We have zero interest in building a closed payment network. You can have value exchange circle-to-circle users, but it has to be open and global so that we can exchange value with anyone and receive value from anyone. And right now, the Bitcoin blockchain lets us do that. And so there's probably, you know, 50 startups here in the audience that are doing things like Circle and other markets around the world. And that's really compelling, because now I can beam dollars or sterling to someone in the Philippines or someone in India or Korea or Japan, and they can receive it instantly as yen. And that can happen, and that can settle in minutes.
Right.
And that's really powerful. So this sort of open network model is what we're behind. And so that what's different today is that we actually have a global open model that everyone can plug into. And so we think that social payments is a really interesting category for inventing the future UX of money in the US and Europe. But we also think now's the time where you can do it and make it work in an open, global, interoperable way. I don't know if you want to add to that.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, the fact is we use the best path to move money that is available to us. So if you're sitting in London and you send sterling and it instantly arrives as dollars from me, there was no blockchain involved in that. There's no, Circle doesn't need to use Bitcoin for that piece. But if I turn around and I send that money to the Philippines and it arrives instantly as Filipino pesos, the blockchain is involved in that because that's the right path for moving that money. It's not sort of the hammer that we have. It's just one of the tools that we leverage to help make this possible. And it's very important to plug into an open ecosystem where other companies can create the same. The three of us could just go create an email company, and our email company would instantly work with Gmail. We don't need a biz dev deal or a contract or anything like that. There's a protocol that we can build on. And that's not been the case with money until now. And we want to be part of that system.
So I guess, it's a bit hard to conceptualize some of this stuff. So is the front end experience that you're envisioning, you know, is it still an app? Is it always going to be an app? And if you're still replicating the same front-end delivery systems that some of these other models have had, how do you make users see the benefits? How do those benefits translate to the people you're trying to acquire?
Yeah. We'd like it to work everywhere people interact with one another and share content. So in messaging systems, across platforms, across social networks, across currencies, not within just one single app.
So that would look like, is there a visual kind of, so I'm a user, I can now send Circle over.
Yeah, I mean, the way to think about that is, there's this whole theme of conversational interfaces, which is the sort of consumer behavior of interacting with people and businesses and others and using messaging as a way to do that. It makes a lot of sense. That's why the core metaphor of the Circle app is messaging.
Mm-hmm.
We think that value exchange and messaging are really tightly coupled. But there's a lot of open platforms for messaging. Like, we don't need to build the next WhatsApp, right? There is WhatsApp or Facebook Messenger or WeChat or Twitter or Slack or anything that's out there. So we want to make sure that people can use Circle anywhere where they're communicating and interacting with people. It's not about just having them use our one app. Our app is always going to be the deepest, fullest, most delightful experience with Circle, I think. Maybe that isn't the case over time. But it's not just about a single app. We're building a service that consumers should be able to take advantage of in a lot of places.
So do you see yourself as competitors to companies? I know there are startups, payment startups, that have successfully leveraged sort of the current infrastructure, like TransferWise, I guess, is a good example of a company that does, kind of international payments in a way that has been very successful. So I guess, how do you see yourself in the context of that? Do you view them as a competitor? And if so, what's the...
I think at a high level, we think that in 5 or 10 years, there's not going to be a business model in charging for payments or money transfer. Just no one will be able to charge for that. Just like there's no business model for charging for sending an email or a text message or sharing content on the internet, at least for consumers. Mm. So any business that's built on the idea of charging a toll for the synchronization of databases is going to, I think, be in a difficult place. But the way we've built Circle is that you should be able to move value between currencies instantly and have instant availability of value and do that without fees. But I like to ask people, when's the last time you sent a cross-border email or had an international web browsing session? Like, the internet doesn't care. It doesn't think that way. And we want to make money work that way. And that means, you can transmit value between dollars and sterling and soon euro without fees. The best economics that a consumer can get on the planet. That's pretty cool. But we don't look at sort of money transfer companies or remittance companies as competitors, because we actually don't think that is going to exist as a category in 5 or 10 years.
So I guess there's another element to that is that, eventually you guys have to kind of go global. you know, with the platform. And it's been, you know, a couple of years right now, you guys have regulatory approval in two countries. So I guess, do you expect that to accelerate? I know that there's an opportunity now for you guys to look at Europe, but, you know, 2 years, a couple places, that's, you know, there, you know, there could be people who look at that as slow growth. So I guess, how do you battle that? Is there a way forward? Does this accelerate?
Well, I think one thing to note is we're licensed under European Union law. And so the license for, at least for using sterling and euro and providing these services, are for the entire European Union. So 500 million people. So it's not just the UK.
Right.
There's a process to roll that out. And, you know, rolling out a product in a market and having it work well locally takes some work. But that's what we're doing. So Europe is a big focus. And, you know, the U.S. is... It's actually a lot more complicated, as everyone knows, right? We have to go get licenses across the entire U.S.
It's one of those quirks that, you know, you can be passported from the U.K. through the rest of Europe, but you can't be passported from Texas to California. It's a completely different regime.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think we definitely think that there are other major currency zones that are interesting and that we'd love to have work with Circle natively as well.
Gotcha. So I guess, how do you see, let's throw the question in here. I think a lot of people are asking right now. So I guess we've seen a really big news event today. A few people have alluded to it with the potential unveiling of Satoshi Nakamoto. So I guess, does this matter or impact, in your estimation, the technology? Does this, you know, change anything? I know in a business practical sense, you know, it might not, but, you know, the technology has had its struggles of late. Does this do anything? Does this change anything? Thoughts?
I'm still shocked that Jeremy is not Satoshi. No, I think it's obviously interesting news. I think we've both said for some time it doesn't matter a whole lot in terms of governance and product creation and, you know, some of the things that we were doing. Obviously, it does matter, but it doesn't have an immediate impact on what we're focused on. And Satoshi, Craig, has not been involved in some time. And as we've struggled with things like block size and governance, and how do we roll innovation into this open piece of code and you know, forking discussions, there hasn't really been a lot of involvement from the creator, and so it hasn't made a great deal of difference. And it doesn't look like, I mean, it's early days, still lots of questions to be answered, but it doesn't look like it'll make much of a difference going forward.
Jeremy,
related to this governance thing, I think is interesting. Is I remember really well, you know, in the early days of the web. You know, Tim Berners-Lee created CERN web browser, and so he created HTTP and HTML, and, you know, then these other folks created Mosaic, and they forked, basically. They created their own stuff, and then they all quit and went to a startup, Netscape, and Netscape created its own version of the web protocols and tried to impose those, actually, on the world and say, no, this is the web. It's no longer this open thing. It's Netscape web. And there was a lot of resistance to that, and there were a lot of battles and governance battles and who's going to control the future of the web and the protocols, and it's very similar to where we are today. And what was interesting is Tim Berners-Lee, and I'm not saying Satoshi should do this, or Craig or whatever, you know, sort of galvanized industry and academics and computer scientists and created the World Wide Web Consortium, the W3C, to create a standards body to actually evolve the technology of the web. And so we've been very vocal about that. We think we need a standards body for the Bitcoin blockchain in particular. We don't think it should just be controlled by core devs who have commit access. We actually think there needs to be a governance process where you can actually, you know, have broad participation in a structure. And so maybe this will be an impetus to that. Who knows?
Mm. So it's a potential opportunity to be addressed, maybe?
It could be. I mean, I think the governance issue is tricky. We've been involved in a lot of standards over the years, and there isn't a model that I think we would say that's what Bitcoin needs. It's not just because there's money or because there's consensus and there's mining communities and there's, you know, there's a lot of different things at play. In some ways, it was a little bit easier with some of the easier in a different way with some of the older standards orgs, in that there was a group of software creators who could get together, and even if they didn't love the collaborative decisions that were made, they would go implement to a spec with a common test suite so that things were interoperable. And this is, there are more forces at play, and it may mean some smarter evolution of a kind of a governance model but certainly something is needed, an interoperable spec with a test suite where multiple implementations can exist.
So we got a few minutes left here. I want to end it with you guys kind of taking us into that crystal ball. You guys have a reputation as innovators, forward thinkers. This time next year, where do you guys see the space and the conversation? I think a lot of our talk today has been about change in conception, change in how people understand this technology. Where are we a year from now? Is it still slow advances in regulation? Is it still slow advances in consumer adoption? What's your take?
I mean, I think social payment apps and the consumer face of all of this are going to scale out a lot in the next year in all around the world, but at least in the markets that we're focused on. And I think we're getting to a point where this model of using the blockchain as a kind of underlying open settlement network that people plug existing currencies into, I think that model is going to get a lot more scale. And so I think that idea that money can work similar to email, we'll see a lot more proof points of that. And the consumer experience will be, dollar being sent, and the recipient will be, peso being received, and it'll be a seamless, invisible thing to them. So I actually think we're going to see a huge improvement all around the world in the consumer possibilities and experience. I also think we may see, the first, large banks and financial institutions directly trade in Bitcoin, directly settle transactions in Bitcoin. We may see other large social payment apps and P2P payment apps add blockchain support so that they aren't just closed networks and they can be interoperable. So I think those are some of the things that are possible in the next year. Mm-hmm. On the regulatory side, there's progress being made all over the place. I mean, it's actually a very favorable environment for fintech companies. There's a lot of government involvement, interest, collaboration, open arms. Let's work together and figure out how to make this possible for the benefits possible for consumers and do without the risks.
John, final thoughts?
Yeah, I would just to ladder on all of that. I think the one thing that would be great to see change would be with the banks globally, who would be the ones to agree to work with some of these innovative companies, banking MSBs, blockchain or otherwise. Bearing in mind that the compliance departments of these banks are the de facto regulators for these fintech companies. So seeing some forward thinking in that area, I would be hopeful for.
Cool. All right, I think that concludes our session. A round of applause for these guys. Thanks for coming.
Great. Thanks. Thanks.
All right. I'll be very quick. Got a couple of housekeeping items. By the way, I didn't know that was my theme song now. I just thought that was going to be the opener, but I'll take it. A couple quick things. With Satoshi apparently revealing himself, I'm sure that one of our sessions with Gavin and Vitalik and a couple of the other core developers is going to be pretty packed. And as this is a sold-out event, I want to just make sure that everybody knows there's a separate room on the 7th floor with a live feed for all of the track sessions that are happening downstairs. So to the extent anything gets a little bit over capacity, we'll direct you up to the 7th floor. Very easy to get to. It's directly in the back corner here. So if you do want to get a seat at some of those, then please make sure that you get there early and move to the back of the room. We have a networking break sponsored by Circle right now to kick off the morning. And as you try to log on for Wi-Fi, we have our sponsored Wi-Fi from Chain. Chain.com is the password. And believe me, you're going to want to log in at some point because they're having a fantastic contest where they're going to be potentially giving away three sets of tickets to a show that rhymes with Schmamilton. Which are probably the only tickets that are harder to get right now than the ones right here. So enjoy the networking break. Thank you very much for taking part in the morning session.
I'm a fireball.
I was born.